y'all. It's your boy Mike Rashid, and I have the privilege and the honor to be here with a living legend, the one and only, the Sultan. My man Flex Wheeler. How you doing, man?
Good, man. Many people would be happy to say hopefully, and happily it's only one of me out there, or else, man, we'd be really
No doubt. Really appreciate you coming out, man. Hope you're enjoying the beautiful weather.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I'm a little overdressed here because it was storming just yesterday, right?
Yeah.
It's nice now.
He really just didn't want to make me look bad.
I appreciate that.
Thanks for making me look too bad. But nah, man, I just, through my journey through fitness and this whole industry and this whole process, you know, it's an honor for me to get to be able to sit down with the likes of yourself or like Phil Heath, who I've sat down with recently, mm-hmm. and you know, just other people that I admire, that I look up to, and that I respect. And I respect you guys' drive, the motivation, the success that you guys have accomplished. And of course, I am striving for success myself, you know. So, who better to talk to than successful people, you know? So, I wanted to get your perspective on success because, I mean, what I'm finding is it can be a lot different from person to person.
Sure, definitely. I think it is. And first to address what you said, I mean, that's thank you. I mean, no matter, you know, whether you're black, white, straight, gay, or whatever, you know, first and foremost, you just want to be accepted for what you do and for having the new generation of guys come up and they, you know, respect and accept what I've done. I mean, that's the true honor.
Right.
You know, going out and doing something, whether you run a certain speed or hit a golf ball a certain way, that's not the privilege of it is just the privilege is people respecting what you did and giving honor to that.
Right.
So thank you so much. I'm I watch what you done on video, and it's interesting because you asking me what's my version of success, and I look at what you're doing. You're the new generation of what success is, but you're right. It means so many different things to people. I mean, and it's for me, it's changed based on me getting older. When I first entered the sport, and when I was getting ready to exit the sport and everything. So success at the beginning, because I come from nothing. You know, I come from Fresno, California, you know, poor ghetto, you know, welfare, all that stuff, you know, not always having clothes to wear or wearing hand-me-downs or food to eat. So at the beginning, getting into bodybuilding and finding out that I can make a living at it, you know, I was always very forward in saying I'm just about money. I compete based on the money. Driven instinct, and you know, it's because I came from that.
Right.
So that's what I was missing. And then once I made it and I start making money, then success to me was the cars and the jewelry and the clothes, because you know, again, coming from nothing, I pretty much didn't have a great identification of who I was or didn't want to identify to where I came from.
Right.
So then it was having all these possessions and actually, you know, to be honest, to be being very having very low self-esteem about myself, I wanted to drive the $100,000 car or have the fancy watch or clothes because I wanted people to identify to those that's being successful.
Right.
And if I had those things, then you must look at me like I'm successful instead of where I am now. It's the maturity of understanding what I've done is successful and what I continue to do. So it's completely changed throughout the course of, of me getting older and just kind of, you know, as you get older, hopefully we get wiser.
Right.
But then you never stop learning, because now I'm understanding what a new generation of success is. Being here with you and being honored to be able to do this video with you and everything, this is a new generation of success is, and it just keeps growing.
Right. This era, everything is on social media,
right.
And it's easily, everyone's easily accessible.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone who's somebody, you know so much about everybody. Is there anything about Flex Wheeler that you wish you had social media for people to know about you that they don't know?
No, kind of my stuff is out there. I mean, there was a big book written about my life that was released back in 2003.
Mm-hmm.
And I wrote it along with a ghostwriter, and I was just brutally honest. I told the worst of the worst things about me and the best things about me. And it was almost a biblical sense. And the reason I was empowered to do that, because I put all my skeletons out. I mean, I've done some crazy shit around the world. So, but what I did is I read about these characters in the Bible, and I read about the horrific things that they've done, but God still chose them.
Mm.
You know, King Solomon and all these guys. One cat, you know, even sent the soldier out to be killed because he wanted to have sex with his wife.
Wow.
But God still looked at him so powerfully. I'm like, so how how can you be such a, you know, screw up and still have his love and everything like that. So that kind of gave me the mentality to just to be honest in my book. So I was brutally honest about that and everything I'd done up to 2003. And then because the magazines were big back then, I even went out in my interviews. I was just very vocal, you know, in my magazines. Hey, listen, if I ever offended you and anything I'd done all over the world, or, you know, if anybody's suicidal out there like I was, because I was suicidal since the age of, I think the first time I tried to kill myself, I was 13 or 12, something like that. And the last time I was in my late 30s. So I just reached out to people, because what I understood is this, a lot of people who have these problems, whether you're raped or you're homeless or you don't have money or you're on welfare or you're just stuck in a ghetto or the other side of the tracks, depending on, you know, how you sit, they don't really make it out of that, you know. So being that I had to deal with all those things as a child, I wanted to acknowledge all the horrific things that I went through, the hope that some kid that went through maybe one or two of those things could say, well, damn, if he did, how come I can't do it? So that was more or less my thing, is to reflect all the negative and the bad things that I've been through to help other people see, well, no, it wasn't all gravy. Because people only see the glitz and the glory of what you've been through. They don't see any of the hard work and the 10 years you put into it. So I think that's like a misleading, you know, lesson for kids, because they think they're going to be the next Michael Jordan. They want to learn the crossovers and wear all the gear, and they don't even have the basics. So it was my way of trying to just be honest and say, this is who I am, and strip all the garbage off that other people can say, well, damn, he's just a cat. He's sitting on the toilet just like I do. What makes him any different other than just getting out there and trying to do it? So,
are you comfortable with talking about why you wanted to kill yourself?
Sure. No, like I said, it's all out. I mean, most people know it all over. Yeah, you know what?
Like the last situation.
The very last situation, the very last time I tried to kill myself, I think I was retired. So it might have been 2002, somewhere around that. But I was retired already, and you know, I was a pretty wild guy, and I was married. I was married at the time, and I had came to an epiphany where I was going to tell my wife everything I ever done, based on because of the church I went through and my belief. I felt that I needed to divulge all this to her. So in doing so, it's just a hurt that I seen that she went through. Just was too much for me to bear. So I got in my car, and I had a friend from my buddy Tyrell McGuire, my mentor. He gave me as a gift a Desert Eagle 5.0. So I jumped in my ride and I started driving. I'm like, all right, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna get it over with, you know. And I just didn't want to be here. I didn't want to look in her face and see the pain that I caused, and the pain that I caused my kids and everything. So So I was just driving. I was driving up and down LA, and I was trying to figure out how to muster up to get the energy to do it. Because to go deeper, one thing about a person who's suicidal, I think it's like a disease. And the more that you, and I say fail at killing yourself, and if anyone knows about it, you start to think you're just a failure at everything. So it's now it's to prove people wrong, if anyone knows it. So you're actually struggling to do it, not to do it. So I'm trying to muster up the sense to do it and everything. I'm like, man, you know, you're a failure at everything. You can't do nothing right. You can't even kill yourself. Damn, what a punk you are. So it's actually a really slippery slope, because you're not trying to talk yourself out of it. You're saying, what an idiot, what a buffoon. You can't even do shit right, right? So I couldn't do it, so I'm like, you know what, I'm going to take off, I'm going to go to Vegas, I'm going to get drunk, and I hear about people doing that all the time, you know, I'm going to go get drunk and take a whole bunch of pills and do it. And weirdly, you know, like I said, I never heard any positive things come out of me mentally when I was in that mind frame, and finally, this thought came to me. It was like a voice, and it's eerie to talk about it, but, you know, to be honest, it was like a voice. It said, yeah, you know, go ahead and kill yourself so you can come be with me. And I was like, come be with you? I'm like, no, I just want to get away from where I'm at. I don't want anything else. I'm like, yeah. And I always understood as a Christian, even being a derelict, I always understood, you know, when you commit suicide, that's a wrap. There's no asking forgiveness. Almost anything else you can ask, you can't ask for forgiveness because you're dead. So when this voice is like, go ahead and do that so you can come be with me, it's like, whoa. I don't want to be with you. I just don't want to be a part of this. I don't want that. So if I do that, this party that I'm going to go to, it's going to be never ending. I don't want to be at that party there, you know, and I'm making light of it, right? I don't want to be at that party. So I'm like, wow. So I'm like, this ain't an escape anymore. Mm-hmm. I always looked at it as an escape.
Right.
So I put the gun down. I was like, damn. My whole time, I've been struggling trying to figure out how to do this because I wanted to mm-hmm. escape, but I don't want to be where
right.
that's going to take me.
Right.
And that pretty much cured me. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, later on, I got really sick. I have a rare kidney disease that's no cure to, and it's the most aggressive and deadliest kidney disease known to right. man. So in 2003, I had a kidney transplant from it. But the irony of that is the disease doesn't go away. Like, say you had a bad heart, you get a new heart, you're great.
Right.
I get a new kidney, I still have this disease. I there's people who have 3 and 4 kidneys
wow.
that they've had a kidney transplant because mm. of the disease. So now, you know, I kind of, you know, I laugh at God because I'm like, you know, for over half my life, I've been struggling trying to kill myself.
Mm-hmm.
And now you put in front of me this disease and I'm fighting to be here. Man, right. you're jacked up. Mm-hmm. Here it is, I'm playing these jokes, trying to wild out and kill myself and drive mm-hmm. fast and shooting guns and stuff like that, trying to muster up the energy. And now you see, you put something in front of me where I'm fighting. Where's the
stay alive.
Yeah, to stay alive and go, wow, man, you got a bad sense
wow.
of humor,
wow.
you know, to lay that down on me. And you know, I mean, that's my philosophy, you know, way I look at it. So
I'm getting chills thinking about that. Like you said, you spent a good part of your life trying to kill yourself. Now you're spending a good part of your life staying
just
alive.
Just trying to stay here. Just trying to stay. And it's an active process I have to do, you know, throughout the rest of my life. And, you know, a lot of people say, oh, well, Flex, you know, you've done that because, you know, you lost your kidney because of drugs that you use to compete. And I'm like, I wish that was the case. Because
mm-hmm.
if it did, then it stops with me. I wouldn't have to worry about Darius and Nia
right.
and Brandy and Ken and my children.
Right.
But now I have to teach them, and they're aware of the disease because they may get it.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to be aware of it and everything like that. So I'm like, man, if, you know, I've always been a type of guy, listen, if I pissed in my bed, I ain't making no excuses. I right. pissed in it. Land, that's you, dog. Right. You pissed in it.
Right.
Nobody pissed on you. You pissed in it.
Right.
So why start crying about it?
Mm-hmm.
So there's been a number of times I've been in hospitals, you know, all over the world, and like, wow, we don't know if things are going to be good. And my thought was like, did I do this? And they'd be like, yeah, you did this. I'm like, all right, well, whatever's going to happen is going to happen.
Right.
I ain't going to start getting all upset about it now. Because
right.
when it was on and popping and I was on stage and making money, I wouldn't be crying about it. So I ain't
right.
going to sit here and be like, woe is me.
Right.
Why this happened to me? No, you did it. You know,
right.
so don't cry about it. So that's the most, probably the other irony of this situation is that I didn't cause it. They don't have a cure for it and they still don't know why it happens. I know parents who have 13-year-old kids. We've on their third kidney where, you know, I've had one kidney transplant in 2003 and it's supposed to last up to maybe 7 or 8 years, and here it is almost 13, 14 years and I'm still doing great. So that's again the irony of it. But I, again, like I said, I have to sometimes pick and choose my battle. I can't, you know, change everybody's mind and perception
right.
of me. So let me more or less concentrate just on me and whoever it causes a ripple effect
right.
from that. Okay, then great.
Right.
But you know, this change of people's mind, like you said, you know, getting in a fight with an internet tough guy. I mean, come on, man. I mean, for one, just life is too short. For two, dude, it's probably just getting off.
Yeah,
I'm getting you all upset anyway.
And 10 times out of 10 is not anybody legit.
Yeah.
Legit people don't do that.
No. I always say, and I'll let you talk because sometimes I run my mouth too much. But the same cat who's driving down a freeway flipping you off would not sit here and be like, you
right.
So most of the time the cat who's talking all the garbage on an internet, you know, sometimes I used to do stupid stuff. I'm like,
mm-hmm.
listen, you know who I am,
mm-hmm.
and you know what my shows are. Just come on, we'll hammer it out. You know,
right.
we'll just me and you. We'll just try lay the hammer down
yeah.
and just see what
yeah.
happens. You know,
right.
but that they don't want to do that. So
right.
nah,
man.
Stop laughing, dog.
Nah, I mean, your story is amazing, you know, and I'm sure it's a lot more to it and a lot more depth to it,
yeah.
but just what you said is a lot. And it, you know, and it somewhat shows in your persona and your presence, you know, people that have been through things, whether you want to or not, you're here, you're thriving, and you're doing a lot of good things. You are a teacher now
yeah.
because you've been through school.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you've been to deep waters and
yeah.
came back.
Deep waters, yeah.
So now, you know, there's so many people who will never go through a fraction of what you went through or go through some of the things, and you have that perspective to give them now. So
right.
to me, that's success right there. I mean, that's amazing, you know, and just, you know, your story is far from over. you know?
Right.
You're doing a lot of good things, and...
No, I'm just, it's, and the same as you, I don't think you are, or aware enough, the far reach that you have. It's going to take some time, and you might be more keen to it, but you're not aware fully. It'd take you some years, it'd take you, traveling to foreign distant lands, and someone walking up to you saying, you know, man, you changed my life, or you saved my life, or something like that. That's when you really find out, you know, your true reach and how you can affect. And my thing is, it's like, you know, like some of these characters in the Bible, you know, they took lemon and they made lemonade out of it, and they served it up well so that you don't have to go through this lemon life. You could just have the fruits of my labor and hopefully live through my obstacles and obscurities that I've been through and not have to face that. And that's a beautiful thing. You know, all of us, whatever gift we are given, to be able to understand what that gift is, and then be strong enough, because you're going to have to take some pop shots. Mm-hmm. You put way up here, people just, they're going to, because they're shooting up. And you always say, you know, they're always going to do that. So you got to be strong enough to be able to do that. But no, it's a beautiful thing, man. I think that's more pleasing to me than winning a show or getting into the best fight of my life. It's just, you know, because it's still surreal to to believe someone, when they walked up to you, I named my child after you.
Right.
You know, or even I named my dog after you, or man, I got you on my picture, and every time I think about it, I want to do this, I look at you and like, Flex wouldn't do that. And in my mind, in my honesty, I'd be like, I would struggle not to do that.
Right.
But they just re-strengthened me.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So it's that's contagious thing.
That's one thing I tell people at expos when they come up to me and they tell me, like, you know, in this blog, when you said this, that, and the third, and man, thank you. And I there's so many times I got to stop them. I'm like, look, you do so much more for me.
Yeah.
Than you know, than I do for you guys, because what it do is all of these people coming up, person after person after person, saying these great things that they've obtained from me. I'm like, I can't let these people down, you know. And not to mention, I got kids, and I got myself, and I got my father, my mother, my closest friends. I don't want to let anybody down, and I've made a lot of mistakes, and I'm consciously trying to every day, you know, be better than yesterday, and I'm sincere about it. Even, I think this is such a huge blessing to me right now of sitting here talking, because
it just
reaffirms that just keep pushing in the right way.
Right, and know? Mike, don't be afraid of your mistakes, because I've been to a lot of different churches in my reach of trying to, you know, understand things, and one thing that's always bothered me is when I'm in a church or listen to a pastor talk, and they're so pristine and everything, they've never struggled with sex or with lust or drugs or wilding out. I'm like, hey, how can I sit in a room and be honest with this man, because he's going to make me feel uncomfortable, and B, it's what we all say, you don't know what I've been through, so empower your setbacks and your shortcomings, because that enables you to talk to that cat who got that problem and help them now and be able to pull them out of that, because you succeeded. So it's not that I capitalized or I haven't learned everything from my mistakes, and I'm still learning. I'm still learning right now, but without my mistakes, I wouldn't be the person who I am, nor would I be able to go and help someone who's struggling with that problem also, because if you know anything about life, when you're talking to somebody who's been through something, if you can't identify to what they've been through by telling them, man, this is what I've been through, and that the same thing, that then you got their listening ear.
Right.
But again, if you're so pristine and you've never struggled in any of those areas, they're gonna look, why are we talking, dog? You don't know me. You don't know what I've been through. But so I think that's also a gift that you just got to understand and be wise enough to try to persevere. And that gift, or that, say, that thorn in your side now is a gift that you can go out and share. Doesn't mean it wasn't painful.
Right.
And it's supposed to be, because when you're sharing it with that person, unfortunately, you know, some emotional things might take you back there, because it's still, you know what I mean?
Right.
But when that person sees the realest of that, now you got them, and you connected.
Right.
And that's why I say, I mean, being a giant that you are now in a media base that you have, I mean, it's probably going to take you some years to understand the people that you touch. I look at the hits that you get on stuff like that, and it's just mind-boggling. But, man, I mean, just with a click, you understand? I mean, that, how much powerful is that? That people are just on edge waiting to hear what you have to say. Right, and that's just, like, and I'll end it with that. It's just, you know, it's always a great saying, you know, with great power comes great responsibility. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, whether, again, whatever it is you're good at, business smart, you're a rocket scientist, you're a teacher, you're a doctor, you're an officer, you've been given a great power. And if you don't respect the responsibility, therefore is your demise.
Right. So, basically, initially it was material.
Yeah, it was
money.
Initially it was money, then it was material things. Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
definitely. So when did you get to a point to where you said that this is not it?
You know, probably like I didn't know it was towards the end of my career, but it was probably 99 where winning a title meant more to me than the money that I made it.
And right.
I think that's when I made my statement on stage at the Olympia, when I got angry and I took off the second place in my statement. I realized at that point, it was like an epiphany, is that, you know, I'm sure everybody been to a show where a person is given the wrong placing, you know, so-and-so gets second, so-and-so gets first, and then, you know, the guy who got second, he's all upset, and the guy who's first jumping up and down, and then like, oh, we made a mistake.
Right.
So all they did is take that medallion off of that person and switch it.
Right.
Now this guy is super happy, who was first, second place, and this guy is now upset, who was first place. So just, I don't know, just at that moment when they put the second place around me, I was like, you know, I'm not number two. Yeah, I'm a winner. You know, you put these around me like it's a shackle that I'm number two. I'm like, no, this is number two. I'm number one. So at that time, it kind of transcended that. No, it's about the competitivism and trying to be the ultimate best at what I could do. So that was probably 99, around the time that actually happened.
Right. So, I mean, you know, watching your career and your growth and the things that you've done, one thing that I admire about you is that you are, first and foremost, a martial artist.
Love it.
And I myself, like, I love Bushido. I love, you know, The Way of the Samurai.
Right.
Like, I read books like Tao Te Ching.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
I Ching. Like, nice. These are books that I read often.
Deep.
You know, and I was a boxer all my life and a huge fan of martial arts and kung fu movies.
Mm-hmm.
Iron Monkey, and, you know. So
you go back to old ones.
Yeah, so it's just fascinating to me that you have that background. How and why did you go from that into bodybuilding?
It's really easy. I started martial arts when I was eight or seven. I started Shotokan, and it was like free lessons that they were given at the local rec center.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember it was movie night, and they had Enter the Dragon on there.
Right.
And man, I just fell in love with Bruce Lee. I got it. Mm-hmm. And so I started martial arts, and I was competing and fighting and everything. And actually, I met a person who's like a mentor, a father, a brother of mine. His name is Tyrell McGuire.
Mm-hmm.
I was actually in police academy, and police officer. I was a good one, though. I was in police academy, and I met his business partner, and he was telling me how good his business partner was as a fighter and everything, and I thought, oh, it's pretty awesome at the time. So we went and met, and Tyrell McGuire, who I was talking about, was, I think he was a fourth dan in Taekwondo, and I think a third or fourth in Kempo. So out of respect and out of his maturity, he said, well, go ahead and why don't you fight my top student, instead of me walking in the door wanting to fight him.
Right.
So he said, you know, why don't you go ahead and fight my top student? So I went and I fought his top student. And fighting to me, it's just a beautiful art, you know, but I believe in 100 miles an hour. I believe in everything I got and everything I throw. So it didn't go too well for his top student, to the point where, you know, Ty actually took it as a disrespectful thing that I just came in there and just not beat a student, but I mean slammed him, swept him, you know, while he's on the ground.
Right.
So again, out of his maturity, and I see it now, being older, out of his maturity, he goes, well, you know, stop, you know, we'll move around a little bit. And that's the word we use in boxing and everything. We'll move around. So it's out of respect. So we'll move around a little bit. And it was just amazing. You know, I thought I was a pretty good fighter, and the things he did to me was very humbling.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it didn't hit me hard nowhere, even though he could. You know, here I am blasting this dude, and he's just touching me everywhere with his feet, just touching everywhere, bing, 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 foot, just ding, 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 ding.
Right.
Which, if you understand, that's a knockout at any second.
Oh, yeah,
you can't stop shit like that, you know. And he's doing it at control speed.
Right.
So I felt humiliated, you know. So I left all pissed off and everything, and we didn't talk for a while, and we ended up seeing each other at a tournament, and I think I took second or something. I had a problem with, I was a headhunter. I love to make head contact. So anyway, you know, he had said, hey, man, you know, I got a couple of ideals, you know, to make it a better fight. And I'm like, dog, why you disrespect me like that? Right. He goes, how did I disrespect you? I'm like, you know, you just touching me. He goes, oh, okay, so you come into my school and you beat down my student in right. front of me and you say that I was disrespectful. Right, right. So we hit it off. You know, he made me a promise. He goes, you know, I'll make you the number one fighter in California in a year. And I think in 3 months, I was the number one fighter in California. And it just became, from there, it became more of a mentorship. And I was always working out. I've been working out since I was probably, 8 or 9 years old, the same, because I was really skinny. My nickname back then was Skinny Kenny.
Right.
So I continued doing it. I continued fighting, and I continued working out. And the gym where I trained at and working out was also the gym where we fought, and we trained in martial arts. So Ty would come to a lot of my events, you know, in bodybuilding and stuff like that. He was supportive and all that stuff. And it got to the point where I kept winning both. And I think I just went to California in 89, which he actually sponsored me to go because I was broke as a joke.
Right.
He bought all my food. He'd take me to the Vons, and he bought all my food for a week and everything. So we went to the... we went to the California, and I end up winning. And he always had this saying. He goes, you know, I tell you, it's just a matter of time. It's just a matter of time. You can achieve whatever you want.
Right.
So after winning to California, I went and fought that Sunday, and I won another championship in body and fighting. And I just, like, which one do I do, man? You know, which one do I do? And at the time, it goes back, but Big Trouble in Little China had just came out.
Right.
And a good friend of mine who passed away was in that movie. And I said, do I fight? Do I try to get in a movie thing, or do I take this bodybuilding thing serious? And he goes, you know what? He goes, you know, he's very philosophical. He goes, it chose you already. Mm-hmm. I go, what do you mean by that? He goes, bodybuilding chose you already, but I'm a good fighter. He goes, you're a better fighter, but there's no money. And back then, there was no money in martial arts. You didn't get a big role in martial arts, like we were talking off camera. Back then, you know, if you're a great martial artist, you come on and do a flurry of all these fancy kicks, and some guy just comes and hits you once and knocks you out. So, and it's over. So it was really disrespectful for a martial artist. So that's how I got into the bodybuilding thing. And it was actually by his push of doing that that helped me succeed in pursuit of the life of bodybuilding.
Right, nice. I, when I lived overseas for a while, and I picked up, like, my background is boxing. Like, I love boxing.
Nice.
And but I did start doing judo, and, you know, got into jiu-jitsu and Kyokushin and stuff like that. And I was pretty good because I was athletic and I had a boxing base.
Right, right.
But I was with some people, man, and I was like, you know, I think I'm going to take this serious. And because I feel like at the end of the day, if you're really good at one fighting system, you can kind of do whatever,
exactly,
you know?
Exactly.
So... But, you know, I was reading about, like, I was always fascinated with, I've always been fascinated with, like, military history and just history in general. Especially in the East, like, with Japan and like, the samurai and the warriors. And it was, like, it was a class. And, you know, they just had a job to protect who hired them.
Right.
And also, but beyond that, in Bushido, it said, like, you know, it basically, now I love watching competitive fighting. Whether it be mixed martial arts or boxing or whatever, I love watching it. I'm a huge fan. I always will be. But it did put in perspective, like, look, it was like you're given a gift. You can really hurt people, you know, and you can really protect people. You can do good things with it. You know, you can teach. You know, you can keep, you know, you can kind of, like, keep kids' heads straight. And there's so many wonderful benefits out of it. But it said you're not supposed to use it as a, like, as a sport, as entertainment,
right.
like potentially hurt somebody.
Sure.
That really resonated with me because even as a boxer, you know, I was really good and I've been far. And I never, when I tell people it was a sport, I never tried to hurt people.
Right.
Like, yeah, you do get knockouts, you do knock people down, but I was trying to outpoint somebody,
hit
them and not get hit.
Right.
It was a sport.
Right.
So it made sense. Like, man, somebody can get hurt like that. I can hurt somebody. At the end of the day, what is me being the champ, but you have brain damage now because of what I did to you.
Right, and that's the beautiful thing between the Far East and here over in the West. And you got that perspective because you lived there. So that honed your skills and everything. Where, you know, fortunate and unfortunate, I come from the West where that's what we're about. You know, I had the privilege of traveling all over Japan and China and everything, and it's always been that class between us. I remember a friend telling me, you know, you Americans, you piss for distance. Yeah. And we piss for accuracy.
And we do.
Yeah. And, you know, it resonated with me. And this was probably 14 years ago when China wasn't really on a map, you know, maybe two decades ago. And they said, you know, you guys built for the now. You know, we built for the future.
Right.
And if you go from 20 years ago where China was and you look at them now, it's amazing what they've done.
Right.
So, but it's fascinating that you say that, because I have to, as you being honest, I have to be brutally honest. I think that was pretty much my whole, I mean, I love the art of fighting, man. I just love the art of fighting, but I understood. And the way I brainwashed myself is if you stand in front of me, then you're saying that you're better than me. And as I would stare at you, I would brainwash myself, okay, you need to leave.
Right.
Because if you step inside the square, then you think you can beat me.
Right.
And that was my way of psyching myself up. But but still, for me, it was still always respect, because if I ever hit the guy hard, I would be the first to help him up. And after, you know, whether I won or not, I'd pick him up and everything like that. But yeah, I see the yin and the yang about that.
Right,
and that's a great thing about Asia, is it's always the yin and the yang, and they're aware of it. Here, we're just aware of just one.
Right.
You know,
right.
So.
So yeah, that was something that really, when I moved back to the States, when you're removed from your environment and, you know, you have all these different thoughts and ideas, you're like, this is what I'm just going to hold this and do it.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you come back to your environment, I come back to my friends starting to compete in MMA and,
you started getting tainted.
I was like, you know, and I was for a minute, and I was training for a minute for it. This was right before I really got big into fitness and started like changing my training to get more into bodybuilding.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I got hurt sparring, you know. I like chipped off bone in my shin.
Right, right.
And I'm like, wow, it hurts so, it's such a small little fracture, but it was the worst pain I ever endured. And all I could keep hearing was,
That's what happens when I heard back then. Mm-hmm.
Cause I'm not using it for good at that point. I was about to use it for entertainment. And at the end of the day, I'm not an animal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm a human and I have a mind.
Mm-hmm.
So let me use that to entertain, so be it, or whatever, or motivate, or what have you. But like I said, I do have respect for fighters who do it competitively. I just chose to step away.
Sure.
It just wasn't my path.
Sure.
I did it, you know, at 12 years old, I was traveling. Like, I did it for a long time, and it's a huge part of who I am. But, you know, I got to a certain point to where I was like, it's time for me to, you know, let that go.
Right, right.
And just be a fan.
Right.
You know?
You know, and it's perception. It's all perception. You know, I use the saying, you know, it's like the glass is half full. And no matter what, the glass is half. So I can look at it as, damn, I only got half left. Or I can be like, man, I got half left.
Right, right.
So however you perceive it in your mind, that's the realism of it.
Right.
So how you perceive it in your mind and how they perceive it
right.
in their mind over there, that is the realist. That's
right.
There's no other way.
Yeah.
And here, so I don't see a clash in it.
What
I understand, I don't see a clash in it. I've always had the ability when I'm grappling with somebody mentally about something and I don't agree, I've always had the ability at the apex when it's about to go wrong to say, you know what, I agree that I disagree.
Right,
we agree,
right,
we disagree.
Right.
Now let's keep it moving. Instead of now you try, if you don't do that, my thought is you're trying to force your thought on me.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not respecting that I have my own brain and I think for myself. You want me to think your way, and if I don't, you're upset.
Mm-hmm.
But if you both respect what each other is saying, then no harm, no foul.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I've been learning that too. I'm learning a lot, you know, lately. And, you know, especially getting more into business and dealing with people. And sometimes you have people who are just not as rational as you would like them to be. And sometimes I feel myself taking these, like, I just withdraw and I just concede. I'm like, okay, I know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
This person don't see it. And it's frustrating to me because I'm all about logic. Like, let's think about this foot. And I used to be very like forceful with trying to get people to understand, but it puts people in awkward positions and it makes things weird, and then I get looked at as the bully when I'm not. I'm just trying to, like, you know, so I am learning more to, like, just fall back and, you know, and just let people breathe.
You know what's interesting, Mike, is you're the breed of a different world. You're the breed of the internet and the power of social media. So how you're learning to hone your different skills are so different. And it's been difficult for me because, I come from, you know, the area of, you know, somebody says something about you in your neighborhood, you go and seek the person out,
right.
and you guys have those, but you can't. you're right, you can't really do that. Mm-hmm. And I had that mentality at the beginning of this social media thing where I would be that way, and mm-hmm. then I would get these private messages from, come on, man, you can't drop to that level. I'm like, you know, I'm thinking, what, every once in a while I would try it. But what I found is, if you drop down, like you said, you back mm-hmm. off a little bit, right. and you try to see it both ways, and you explain your way and their way, 9 times out of 10, if the person is even semi-rational, they'll get it. I've got so many arguments with internet tough guys, you know, mm-hmm. that I'll take a different strategy, mm-hmm. one that I really don't like.
Right.
And
right.
later on, they'd be like, damn, Flex.
Yeah.
I didn't expect you to come at me like that. I thought you'd be all this, that, right, and other, and you won him over. So it's interesting in your way of being successful.
And that's good, because I try to do that as well. Mm-hmm. The beauty of that is you might enlighten that person, but what we don't realize, there's 1,000 other people watching and reading that.
Right. Like,
that's an example of how to
do.
And I always,
whether you win that battle or not,
right,
all the other people are watching.
They get it.
Right.
Learn from it. I'm a firm believer in, you know, I don't learn by people just telling me this is, I learn by watching, and you lead by example.
I call it a peeper. I'm a peeper. Mm-hmm. It's like to step back in a cut and just watch people and be silent.
Right. So like my father, I learned so much from him. Now, he taught me a lot, and I've retained most, and I learned a lot from watching him. Mm-hmm. Even some stuff that I don't want in my life. You know what I mean?
Right.
So, you know, that's what we do. I feel like, no, everybody say, oh, I don't have to be a role model, but I feel like, you know what?
You are.
When you're getting, you know, tons of money, you know, you're living the life, and off of the expense of these people out here, we owe it to them to be somewhat responsible and give some kind of food, some substance for the soul.
Right.
Yeah, I feel like we owe it to them.
Yeah, agreed. And again, that's why I say you're the new breed, and I'm still learning. I'm learning from what you're saying right now, having talks and watching your videos. I mean, again, that was a struggle that I had, because my sister would always get in an argument with me, because obviously I looked different, I was bigger and everything, and I have a very dry sense of humor, you know. Right. So when you're a lot bigger and more intimidating mm-hmm. looking, people would take it as if you're being mean. And she goes, you know, she would always tell me, well, you can't say that way. I'm going, why not? I can't just be me.
Right.
And she would always, you know, I would always say, I don't like living in a glass house. She goes, mm-hmm. but, you know, Kenny, she would always call me Kenny. You know, but Kenny, you do. And I go, mm-hmm. but I didn't ask for that.
Right.
But you're right, and I do agree, and I conceive, and I see it now, that no, you have to, because, you know, you don't take a light and you put it under a table. Your light is to be put out in the middle, and what you're doing, you're a light. You're a beacon for everything you're seeing, everybody that sees you, so that's a responsibility, and it's great to see that young cats like yourselves are coming up, and they are aware of the responsibility and what they're doing, instead of taking that same power that everyone has given you. They've empowered you,
right?
That same power, and then walling out
and
pulling people such in a negative way. Yeah. So that's a beautiful thing about you and what your success is, and your, what I perceive which is success for you and what you're doing now, and today's new movement of the young people who are taking it serious and taking it to the next level. You're at your age right now, what you're doing, man, I was like, you know, I sit back like, damn, where was my mind back then? It was nowhere cerebral, you know, it was nowhere near that cerebral back then. It was just about getting mine.
Right.
And the way you're handling things now, it helps me to readjust myself to continue getting ready for the next following generation, because you always have to reinvent yourself.
Right. Thank you for that.
No, I'm just being real.
Another thing that drew me to you even before we met was the closeness that you have with Stan Efferding.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
and I was I looked up to him as well, but when we actually met and we trained together, I had a higher level of respect for him, because, you know, this man, you know, he's a very successful guy.
Right.
He has a great physique, he's strong, you know, he's late 40s, and he still trains like a madman.
Right.
And I respect that. I'm like, this is something he don't have to do, but that's what he's wired to do.
I feel like,
you know, see, I always tell people, like, my philosophy of training is, you know, we're going to look great, cool, but it really sets us, it makes us, if we're thorough in the gym, we're going to be thorough in real life, and he's so thorough when we train, I'm like, that's the kind of guy that you need on your team.
You
know, and you guys are super close. I've been seeing that for years, and it says a lot about the company you keep, mm-hmm. you know. So, you know, I admire both of you guys, and I want to be in company with you guys. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't want to be in counsel with people who are shallow, who are just about nothing.
Right.
And, you know, because you have success, you know, monetary success can go like that.
You know, a few times,
but when you're rich inside, in my opinion, when you're rich inside, you're you always will be wealthy,
right?
And you know, and the material things will always be there at your disposal. You know, that's why I admire people like in history, like in the Bible, King Solomon.
Right.
You know, he didn't pray for riches, he prayed for wisdom.
Right.
And now you can get anything.
Yeah.
Right? So
yeah.
I look at that as a metaphor as now as like just being rich inside, just a solid person. And that's all I care to be around. And
no, you know, again, it goes back to just somebody thinking that you've done something of any worth, whether it's one penny or not, of any worth. I mean, that is a true value in it. And you're right. You know, I've made a lot of money. I've lost a lot amount of money. I've done it over and over and over. And now I'm doing well, and I'm all
right.
but it's different because I don't care about so much. I mean, I understand my strengths and my weakness, and I think more so now I'm accepting my weakness, and that's just who I am, and I can't fight that battle. I'm my worst adversary I could ever be.
Right.
I've always said the best thing about Flex Wheeler is Flex Wheeler, and the worst thing about Flex Wheeler is Flex Wheeler also, mm-hmm. but I'm aware of my weakness, and I no longer try to fight those, so now I recognize that I am the true value of who I am, not really what I wear,
right.
or not the car that I'm driving. But I happen to like nice things.
Right,
I'm that
right.
type of guy. But it's different now. But I think it's just a evolution of trying to mature
right.
As a person. And like you said, having people that you hold to higher standards, who've held themselves to higher standards mm-hmm. around you. That's why they have the saying, you know, you can't fly around with the eagles, you know, and want to be an eagle while you're hanging around with buzzards.
Right. Yeah.
And a great person who just passed away, his one of his thoughts was, great thing about learning is different than money, it's different than anything else, because no one can never take that away from you.
Right.
You know, no one
right.
can never take that away from you.
That's true, man. So, okay. You know, martial arts, bodybuilding, I don't care winning an Olympia or not, you were, everybody agrees, that guy. You were the one, you know. You were the gold standard of the perfect physique, you know. What was your, did you have, like, since you did have a martial arts background, did you have a certain Zen approach to bodybuilding?
No, you know, I'm brutally honest to a fault where it's probably not good, but you know, I was very naive in bodybuilding. I can vaguely remember my thoughts because I was almost like a machine. It was just something in front of me and I just did it. I had no pre-thought in doing anything. I was strategic in what shows I went to. I knew I was ranked number second. So my philosophy, okay, I can go to any show that Ronnie doesn't show up at and I should mm-hmm. be able to win. And that was my thought. But now, you know, remove myself from it, I see things different. But no, I was unlike, and again, I think it's more or less, I wasn't a historian of bodybuilding
right.
like some of the other guys are. And the internet wasn't available. And
right.
Where I came from, we didn't have magazines in our gyms because it was just really poor. So
right.
it was just something to do. Instead of being Crippin' or Bloodin', it was mm-hmm. just going to gym
right.
or stealing drugs or whatever. It just came natural to working out. And then I started hanging around guys who worked out and fought. So
right.
I was always around them, and it kept me away from bad things. But no, I mean, unfortunately, no, I didn't. But I'm kind of what you would call, a realist.
Mm-hmm.
I don't walk around thinking that I'm going to win everything. I don't walk or everything's going to be great.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't walk around thinking I'm going to lose everything. I more or less choose to look at it that it's going to turn out bad.
Right.
But my mentality doesn't allow me to put 100% into it.
Right.
Thinking that maybe I can change things around because I'd rather be prepared for the worst.
Mm-hmm.
And if it turns out gravy, that's
a
cupcake.
Bonus.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, but
right.
Be preparing yourself for the best, and then, you know, something goes wrong, you're not prepared for that mentally, mm-hmm. physically, or anything else. So I really didn't have that type of approach to it or anything. I'm superiorly competitive. I love to lose. I mean, I'm very emotional. If I win, I'm crying. If
right.
I lose, I'm crying. If I'm getting ready to fight,
right.
tears are coming
yeah.
down my eyes. I'm like, listen, I can't control these tears, but I
right.
can control these,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's a different language. So I just love to lose, and I'm very competitive, and
mm-hmm.
I always wanted to try to be the best, and I wanted
right.
to compete against the best guys, to try
mm-hmm.
to show where I was. And I, again, to be honest, I think that came from me not having too much self-esteem because
right.
of my childish background that I had. So it was, to me, it was always about proving myself, but not to everyone else,
right.
about proving myself
yourself.
To me.
Because mm-hmm.
I always had to look at myself in the mirror, and my thought is if I can go home and I can look in the mirror and say, all right, you're still a man, then
mm-hmm.
I've achieved that. But the
right.
worst thing is to not be able to reflect oneself and to
right.
look at yourself in the mirror and say, this is who you really are.
Right.
So.
Right, right. Now, I appreciate this. Listen, y'all, you have, you know, you have Flex Willa right here. You have, you guys probably, when you seen Mike Rashid and Flex Willa, you thought you was going to see us with our shirts off, lifting, sweating. But no.
That's gay. No, that's, no, I'm serious. You got to edit that.
It is, though. Oh, come on, Drew. Okay, you got,
you
got.
Sleep on this dog?
You guys have Flex Willa here, one of the best bodybuilders that ever graced your stages and your eyes, and he just dropped megaton bombs on y'all. I try to tell you guys all the time, it's so much more to life than your abs and your body and your physique. That's a byproduct of the discipline, the hard work, you know, and it's good. It's a good, like, I salute all of y'all who you went from skinny kid to you jacked or whatever your fitness goals are, because I was a skinny kid too, but that's a small part of the whole thing. Like, this man just dropped megaton bombs on my brain, and I'm sure a lot of you guys. So y'all soak that up. We trying to give y'all something more than just the regular stuff you see on Instagram and Facebook and YouTube. You know, it's so much more to life than just lifting and how we look with our shirts off, man. It's how we look, how we in here, you know what I mean? That's what's important. Y'all hold on to that. And when y'all see people like Flex, y'all need to get out and support. Every time I see him somewhere close, I'm going to be there to hear him, because this is wisdom. This is what we need, you know, our to feed our souls, you know what I mean? So y'all all about your macros and getting your meals in, get your soul food in too, you know what I mean?
That's right.
So, man, thank you for coming out.
No, thank you, and it's an honor. Thank you so much for coming out, for inviting me out, bro. It's a truly honor. When we started talking about this a couple of weeks ago, I was like, really, dog? You know, I still get pumped about this. And again, I mean, just what you're doing at your age and the power that you have, and even more so scary, the awareness that you have. Because I didn't have this awareness when I was your age. It took me a little bit longer. But the awareness you have and what you're doing and everything is truly a knowledge. And if you guys want to see us bang in a gym, go ahead, you know, check out the video, and you can hit us up and ask us what body part you want us to train. But, you know, we just made a bigger decision that we want to go deeper on you guys with some different type of game. You've seen me train. You've seen him train. But, again, if you guys really want to see us do a certain body part, go ahead and drop a dime on us and let us know what you guys are thinking about, and we'll put that together next time.
Sure.